I think it's one of the more remarkable properties of life, actually, that just taking mammals, that the largest mammal, the whale, is in terms of measurable quantities, that is of its physiology and its life history, is actually a scaled up version of the smallest mammal, which is actually the shrew, but a mouse is you know, very close to that, and everything in between, that they are scaled versions of one another, and in a systematic, predictable way to, you know, sort of 80-90% level. So, you know, the kinds of things that you might measure might be as mundane as the length of the aorta, which is the first tube coming out of your heart, or it could be, you know, something as sophisticated and complex as, you know, how long each one of these mammals, for example, is going to live, or how long it takes to mature. So all of these things scale in a very predictable way, and they scale in a way that's non-linear. So even though it's simple, it's highly non-linear, and that can be expressed in the following way. So perhaps the most well-known of these is the scaling of metabolic rate. And metabolic rate is maybe the most fundamental quantity of life, because metabolic rate simply means how much energy, or maybe just how much food, does an animal need to eat each day in order to stay alive? You know, everybody's used to that, everybody's familiar with that as sort of roughly 2,000 food calories a day for a human being. So you can ask, what is that for different mammals? And what you find is that they're related to one another in a very simple way, despite the fact that metabolism is maybe the most complex physical chemical process in the universe. For all we know, it's phenomenal, because metabolism is, you know, taking essentially almost inorganic, something that's inorganic, and making it into life. So that's, and so here's this extraordinarily complex process, and yet it scales in a very simple way, and you can express it in English. It can be expressed quite precisely in a very simple mathematical equation. But in English, it's roughly speaking that every time you double the size of an organism, from say 2 grams to 4 grams, or from 20 grams to 40 grams, or 20 kilograms to 40 kilograms, or whatever, and just doubling anywhere, instead of what you might naively expect, double the size, you double the number of cells, roughly speaking, therefore you would expect to double the amount of energy, the amount of metabolic energy you need to keep that organism alive, because you have twice as many cells. Quite the contrary, you don't need twice as much. Systematically, you only need, roughly speaking, 75% as much. So there's this kind of systematic 25%, one quarter, savings. And it turns out that anything else you measure, as I mentioned a moment ago, scales in a similar way, with this sort of 25% rule occurring in some interesting way. So, for example, if you take mammals, we have beating hearts. We have a circulatory system with a beating heart. So every time you double the size, there's a systematic decrease in heart rate. You know, as you most people are familiar with, an elephant's heart beats much slower than ours, and much slower. Ours beats much slower than a dog's or a mouse, for example. And that also obeys this kind of quarter power scaling. So in a very systematic way, we see this repetitive nature. And what is amazing about that is that, you know, each animal, each one of these animals, and by the way, it's not just true for animals, it's also true of plants and trees, but each one of these organisms, you know, has evolved by natural selection. Each subsystem has evolved evolutionarily by natural selection. Each cell type Each genome that comprises of the organism has its own unique history, you know, that has ended up being this particular organism. So you might have expected, in fact, you would sort of think of that, and often colloquially we think of it as some kind of random process, natural selection, and that you would therefore have expected, if you look at something like metabolic rate, or length of aortas, or whatever it is, lifespan, they would sort of be randomly distributed because they would simply represent or reflect the evolutionary history of that organism or of the components of that organism. Quite the contrary, as I say, it's not that. Somehow, natural selection has been constrained by some underlying principles. And what I have spent quite a lot of time thinking about and developing a theoretical structure based on underlying principles and put into a mathematical framework for understanding where that regularity comes from and why it should be this number 1/4. Where does that magic number 4, so to speak, arise? And the work that I did with some marvelous biology colleagues, Jim Brown and Brian Enquist, developed this, very, what I consider very elegant theory, that what these scaling laws are reflecting are in fact the generic, universal, mathematical, and physical properties of the multiple networks that make an organism viable and allow it to develop and grow and so on. And the ones, you know, we're all familiar with many of them, like our circulatory system and our respiratory system, but our neural system is like that, it transmits information. But these are networks that have evolved to distribute energy from something macroscopic, like your heart, I mean, a pool of blood, down to deliver oxygen to the cells by going through a hierarchical network, delivering, as I say, oxygen resources, metabolic energy to the cells. And it is the universal properties, the universal mathematical properties of those networks that transcend the evolved design. So the same mathematical, and this is extremely important, it's the same mathematical and physical principles apply to a mammal, which has a beating heart, as applies to a tree. And a mammal, you know, our circulatory system is a bunch of tubes, like in your house, the plumbing in this building that we're sitting in. That's our circulatory system. But a tree and a plant, they're not like that. They're a bunch of fiber bundles kind of joined together like electrical cables that spray out, and that's what you see when you see a tree. In each branch, there's actually just these fibers transporting fluid to the leaves and so on. But even though they don't have beating hearts, as we well know, and yet they satisfy the same mathematical principles. And those mathematical principles give rise to this quarter power scaling in mammals, but also in plants and trees, but also in fish and birds and crustacea in principle and insects and so on. And that's the idea.